Good morning. On behalf of St. James Episcopal Church in Eufaula, Alabama, I'd like to welcome you to this online service of morning prayer. Morning prayer is a service that is found in our Book of Common Prayer, and you may follow along using the bulletin that we have linked in this Facebook Live posting. You may also find the bulletin on our website or at BCP Online, which stands for Book of Common Prayer Online. We are blessed by your presence and are so glad that you have joined us. If you would, take a moment right now to let us know how you're doing in the comments below. Send an emoji, say hello, put in a prayer request. We take those prayer requests and place them on our parish prayer list. We want to know that you are gathered with us now, live as one body of Christ. That is so important during these days of social distancing to do. So if you take a minute to do that, we would greatly appreciate it. Also, if you would, share this service right now on your Facebook page. These days, it's easy to forget exactly what day it is where one day begins to kind of look like the next. We want everyone in our parish family to know that it is Sunday and we are gathered together as one family, worshiping God and giving praise. It's also a way for us to invite those in our community and the surrounding area to the fount of hope, mercy, and forgiveness that we have in Jesus the Christ. So if you would do that, we would greatly appreciate it. A few announcements before we begin. Our bishop, Bishop Russell Kendrick, has suspended all in-person gatherings through the end of May. He is working with a committee right now to determine exactly when we will open the church back up for in-person gatherings. They are looking at the health and safety of those in our parish, our diocese, and in each community that we serve in making that decision. We would love to be together, but we also want to be sure that we protect the health and safety of each person in our parish family and in our community. Right now, we are planning an in-person gathering in our courtyard on Pentecost Sunday, which is the last Sunday of May. You will hear more on that as word becomes available. So that is not set in stone. It's a service that may or may not happen, but we'll know more this week. And when we know, we will convey that to you. But we can't wait to be together. But in the meantime, we will continue to have these virtual gatherings throughout the course of the week and hope that you will join us. Our food pantry remains open. During these days of challenge, it is important for us to keep those cupboards stocked. And if you would like to donate non-perishable items such as rice, beans, canned goods, macaroni, grits, and other non-perishable items, you may drop them by the church Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays from 8 to 12:30. Our food pantry hours are from 9 to 11:30 on Tuesdays. So if you know of somebody who is in need of food, please send them to the church. Have them call us, have them come by. We would love to serve them. We have safety protocol in place for both volunteers and patrons to keep all safe. We would like to thank all of those in our parish family who have given of their time and talent in providing readings or music for today's service. We thank Mary Jo Riddle, who will be doing our first reading and the reading of the psalm, Sandy O'Dell, who will be doing our second reading and the reading of the gospel, and to Sherry Musgrove, who will be doing our prayers of the people. And a special thanks to Billy Wilburn, who will be playing the piano on our opening hymn, and you are invited to sing along, and he will also be performing a solo during our offertory. If you would like to take part in our service in any way by offering a reading or a musical talent, please give me a call or call the church office. We would love to have you. If you have a pastoral care or concern of any kind, or know of anybody who does have one, please give me a call. My number is found on our website as well as in all of our parish publications, and I would love to hear from you during these days of challenge, even if it's just to say hello. We're doing this a little bit different today. We're once again outside. It is a beautiful day here in the late spring. The fountain sounds beautiful. Those beautiful waters reminding me of the water that we have in our own baptism. The sunlight will become our candles today, so excuse me for being a little less formal, but I couldn't help myself. Thank you for being with us. We are blessed by your presence. And now morning prayer.
here.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. If then you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia. Let us say together the Venite. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. I would now, at this point, say please be seated for the psalm, but you're at home, so you probably already are seated. We will now have the psalm and the first reading.
Please read along with me Psalm 31, verses 1 through 5, 15 to 16. The reading can be found in your bulletin or on page 622 in the Book of Common Prayer. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Incline your ear to me. Make haste to deliver me. Be my stronghold, a castle to keep me safe, for you are my crag and my stronghold. For the sake of your name, lead me and guide me. Take me out of the net that they have secretly set for me, for you are my tower of strength. Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord, O God of truth. My times are in your hand. Rescue me from the hand of my enemies and from those who persecute you. Make your face to shine upon your servant, and in your loving kindness, save me. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles, Acts chapter 7, verses 55 to 60. Filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. "Look," he said, "I see the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." When he had said this, he died. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our first canticle is the first song of Isaiah. Let us say it together. Surely it is God who saves me. I will trust in him and not be afraid. For the Lord is my stronghold and my sure defense, and he will be my savior. Therefore you shall draw water with rejoicing from the springs of salvation. And on that day you shall say, "Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name. Make his deeds known among the peoples. See that they remember that his name is exalted. Sing the praises of the Lord, for he has done great things, and this is known in all the world. Cry aloud, inhabitants of Zion. Ring out your joy, for the Great One in the midst of you is the Holy One of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen." And now the second reading.
A reading from the first epistle of St. Peter, 1 Peter 2, 2 through 10. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow unto salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Come to him, a living stone, though rejected by mortals, yet chosen and precious in God's sight. And like living stones, let yourself be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, "See, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and whoever believes in him will not be put to shame." To you then who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the stone that the builders rejected has become the very head of the corner, and a stone that makes them stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of the darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The word of the Lord.
Our second canticle is the Song of Mary. Let us say it together. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him, in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. And now, a reading from the Gospel of John.
A reading from the Gospel of John, John 14, 1 through 14. Jesus said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him, and you have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his work. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe in me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it."
God before us, God beside us, God behind us, God above us, be also now between us, a bridge through which your truth may move. In the name of the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Who's afraid of the dark? I mean, if we're honest, we're all just a little bit afraid of the dark, aren't we? We're walking through a dark hall and there is that inclination, that urge to turn on a light. It brings us back to when we were kids. And when the lights were on in our bedroom, everything seemed right with the world. We were confident. We were sure of everything around us. And the minute the lights switched off, fear replaced that surety. And we were afraid. Afraid not necessarily of what was there, but what might be there, lurking under our beds or in the closet. Or maybe you've been on a trail in the woods, one that you're very familiar with, and then darkness descends. And suddenly, that trail that you knew like the back of your hand becomes less sure, and you lose your sense of direction. You lose your way. And there are many forms of darkness in our lives and in the world around, not just the physical absence of light, but it can be a figurative absence of light. It can be an inability to see things clearly or to see something with clarity. It can be confusion or doubt, an unknowing. How many times have you heard, "Well, he or she is in the dark," or you've even said, "Well, I'm sorry, I'm in the dark on that particular subject." And darkness and confusion and a lack of clarity can creep into our relationship with God. It can leave us fearful. It can leave us seeing God in a light that isn't true. It can lead us to forgetting the promises of God and the very character and the nature of the divine in our lives and in the world. You see, we live in a world that can be harsh. There is a competitive culture and a violent pace of life that can leave us with no time to truly be kind, that kind of margin that we have in life to take the time to reach out and to touch someone with kindness and with mercy. We become in such a hurry, a harried pace. And we can begin to look at our lives like that, to look at ourselves like that, to look at others like that, and to look at God like that, with a harsh and bitter light. Richard Dawkins, the evolutionary biologist and author, said this. He said, "The God of the Old Testament is arguably the most unpleasant character in all of fiction, jealous and proud of it, unjust, unforgiving," and he goes on and on. And we might expect that from Dawkins, but we don't expect that in our own lives, and so we're embarrassed to admit that sometimes we see God in that light that culture tells us is the God of Holy Scripture, and we forget Holy Scripture and the life of God in the life of God's people. And when we do this, when we see God in this harsh light, we forget that God is a God of forgiveness and mercy, and when we then don't accept that forgiveness and mercy, and we can't give others and give the world what we don't have, and it becomes self-fulfilling in our own life as our lives lack kindness. And yet, Holy Scripture tells us that God is a God of forgiveness and mercy. My favorite comes from Exodus 34, where God reveals himself to Moses. And he said that he is a God that is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. So how do we keep from seeing God in this harsh light? How do we keep from allowing that harshness, that lack of kindness, from infiltrating and infecting our lives and the way we not only relate to God, but relate to ourselves and relate to others? Well, I see in today's readings from 1 Peter and from John's Gospel a word about the faithful character of God, forgiveness, and how we can step out of the dark and into the light. In 1 Peter, Peter is writing to a people who are going through a great deal of suffering. And it is a letter about perseverance in the face of suffering, where he talks about the promises and the faithfulness of God. Because when we are in the midst of reversal or in the midst of a suffering of any kind, we can begin to think that we deserve it, that it is because of our past that we are being treated this way. And we can begin to think that God is treating us this way, because who wouldn't treat us this way, looking at ourselves with that harsh light? And yet Peter writes to the people, and some people think he was writing from Rome, where he too was going through a great deal of suffering at the hands of the Emperor Nero, where he was ultimately crucified. 1 Peter says this, "In order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." He's reminding them of the character and the mercy and the forgiveness of God, who is with them always and everywhere. The character of God, who has brought you out of your past and into today, and who promises you tomorrow. I see shades of this harshness, this lack of clarity with God, in Philip's words in John's Gospel. He says to Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied." And Jesus says to him, "Philip, you've been with me all this time, and you don't know the Father?" Almost as if to say, through what I have done, through my healing of the sick, giving sight to the blind, hope to the hopeless, forgiveness, announcing the mercy of God, and you don't know the Father. I sense Philip thinking in his mind, "Yes, but that mercy, that healing, it's not for me. So show me one more time. Tell me one more time that that's meant for my life, that that's something that I can live into in relationship, true relationship, and I can share with the world." And then Jesus says, "Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." You see, Jesus embodies the kindness and the mercy of God. And we need to hear that. And we need to be continually reminded that God is bringing us out of darkness and into light, because it is so easy in a harsh world to forget that. And we can't live in the present. We can't live into relationship with God. We can't live into relationship truly with others until we can deal with our past through forgiveness, because it is only then that we can share mercy with another, that we can share grace. And that is the secret to every relationship that we have in this world. It is the secret to the healing of the world, and a healing that we can bring about only with the help of God and only by being reminded of God's character, mercy, and forgiveness. Because until we accept it, we will see God in a harsh light. We will see ourselves in a harsh light, and we will see others in a harsh light, unable to share the true love and forgiveness and mercy that we have been given. I know a man, who is continually reliving the past. He does his best to walk this walk of faithfulness, but he gets to a point where that past comes back up and he thinks, well, how could God possibly love me? I mean, with all the things that I've done, he can't put his past behind him. He thinks that God is angry with him. He can't accept the mercy and the love that is the character of God because of the way he sees God as vengeful, vindictive. We have a call by the power of the Holy Spirit to manifest this kindness and forgiveness in a world that so desperately needs it, a world that lacks it. And the foundation of love in every relationship is a habit of mercy and kindness. God shows it to us over and over and asks us to not only meditate upon it, but to go and do likewise. You see, this mercy gives us that margin in which to look at our lives. It creates repentance, a time of turning to God. As we read God's word, as we meditate upon the life of Jesus, this character, this disposition, this mercy, as we are reminded of it, it manifests itself in our lives. And we are not just reminded, we are empowered. We all need mercy. And through Jesus Christ, we have it. Who's afraid of the dark? Today and every day, God calls us out of the dark, out of the darkness of our past that keeps us paralyzed there, and calls us into the light of today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen. Let us say together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the way of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon the earth, your saving health among all nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. Your intercessions are invited either silently or aloud. We pray for Donald, our president, Kay, our governor, Jack, our mayor, and all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world during this time of challenge. Give them wisdom. We pray for our armed forces, first responders, and all of those who work to protect and serve our communities. We pray in thanksgiving for all of those who work in essential jobs, the medical field, those who provide necessary supplies, the truck drivers, those who stock shelves, and all who supply need. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, especially Stella, Summer, William, Scott, Renee, Trevor, Shannon, Chad, and Chuck, and those you name silently or aloud. We give thanks for the life and ministry of Betsy Lawrence, Jimmy Calton Sr., Lawton Riley, Dennis Biddy, Paige Garrison, and Mary Jo Whittle, who celebrate birthdays this week, and Ed and Paige Garrison, who celebrate their anniversary this week. We pray for those who suffer as a result of COVID-19. Give them comfort and healing that only you can give. We pray for those who work for a COVID-19 cure and vaccination. Give them wisdom. Shine a light on their research. We pray for all doctors and nurses. Give them courage, wisdom, and a spirit of perseverance. We pray for the anxious, the lonely, those suffering from fear. Comfort them in the knowledge that you hold all things in the palm of your hand.
Almighty God, for those cares and concerns we have spoken aloud, those named in our hearts, and those known only to you, we offer in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us pray a collect for our Jubilee year of the Diocese of the Central Gulf Coast. Lord God of all creation, fill us with your grace as we remember your kindness and goodness towards us through providence and through struggle. And let the trumpets proclaim the year of Jubilee, a year of the Lord's favor, as we dedicate ourselves to reorient our mission efforts to renew your gospel in our midst. May your Spirit inspire us, we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. A collect for the stewardship of creation. O merciful Creator, your hand is open wide to satisfy the needs of every living creature. Make us always thankful for your loving providence and grant that we, remembering the account that we must one day give, may be faithful stewards of your good gifts through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. The Collect of the Day. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A Collect for Peace. O God, the author of peace and the lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, and to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in your defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. At this point in our service, we would normally have our offering, where we would take up a donation for the life and the ministry of St. James Episcopal Church. If you would like to support the life, the mission, and the ministry of St. James as we bring the good news of Jesus Christ to Eufaula, Barber County, and the world, you're welcome to do so. We have opportunities for you to do online giving through our website. There are several different methods. You may also, of course, mail in a donation to the church. We thank you in advance for your consideration and your giving. And now our offertory, which is a little bit different from our bulletin. I'm a little bit out of order, but Billy Wilburn will sing for us the prayer with Lead Us, Lord. Thank you, Billy.
Guide us with your grace.
Let us say together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Do not live in fear. Remember that God made you, God loves you, and God, in God's loving kindness, will never forsake you. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Thank you so much for being with us today. We were blessed by your presence. We hope that you have a wonderful and blessed week. Until we meet again, either in person or virtually, God's peace and blessing be upon you this day